We have a wonderful expert on Indian folklore, Professor Dataram Purohit, to conduct this session for us. I just had a few opening remarks. As we all know, our own Indian traditions of performance, going back to the Natyashastra and even before, because after all, Natyashastra came after hundreds of years of living theatre and performance arts. We know that they are, as distinct from other traditions, composite traditions. They have song, music, dance, dialogue, poetry, acting, and all of these together give rise to a very rich repertoire of narrative, dramatic, poetic, and performative traditions. And the Jatra is one of these. Now, from Dr. Chotarai's own abstract, it seems he wants to take it all the way back to millennia before the present era and then bring us up to date. This is a very vast I'm also going to request everybody to mute their mic for the time being, if you don't mind, because there's a lot of background noise. तो मुझे लगता है कि कम से कम थोड़ा सा नैरोइंग डाउन होना आवश्यक है एंड टू मी आई जस्ट वांटेड टू सिग्नल वन और टू थिंग्स व्हिच आई पर्सनली फाउंड इंटरेस्टिंग अबाउट दिस फॉर्म वी नो दैट ऑल आवर रिच परफॉर्मेटिव नैरेटिव ड्रामेटिक आर्टिस्टिक लिटरेरी कल्चरल म्यूजिकल फॉर्म्स गो थ्रू अ ट्रेमेंडस ऑल्टरेशन because of colonialism and modernity. So this is one inflection point. Now, when it comes to the Jatra itself, many people trace it back to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and the various types of Krishna theater, theatrical performances. But so that's what, so the first point I want to make is one can do a historical recap or study or exegesis of a tradition. But I'm not sure how far that's going to take us because it will be basically a narrative analysis. I think we need an argument. That's my basic contention. We need an argument. And for that, one inflection point that I'm going to propose is the colonial period, because all our arts undergo a very important change, transformation during colonialism. The second inflection point to me is the partition, because even if you think about the Jatra as a form, we know that after partition, the troops were divided, and unfortunately, so were the themes. So those that remained in Bengal, West Bengal, that is, continued to perform Hindu themes, but many who went over to the other side, to East Bengal or what is now Bangladesh, they stopped doing the largely religious Jatra performances. So that is a second inflection point to me. And then, of course, we can talk about the impact of digital technology. Prior to that, the movies, which practically, you know, did away with several of these performances, and proscenium theater and so forth, which is a part of the modern transformation. And when we think about the Jatra, of course, all the different complex performances that were a part of it, including the Panchali, which, of course, Satyajit Ray uses in his evocative trilogy, where he talks about Pathir Panchali, which, of course, comes from Bibhuti Bhushan Bandopadhyay. So with these few words, I wish Dr. Chotarai all the best. We congratulate her. She's a proud mother of a bonny lad, a boy, and I think her husband is also with her in her joy, and we wish her all the best in finishing her project. Thank you all so much, and may I now please hand it over to Professor Purohit. And I once again apologize. I think my video is frozen up. If you hear my voice, wonderful. I'm going to mute my mic now. Go ahead, please. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I think I don't need to speak much about Sharmila Chatterjee. She's a PhD in sociology of popular theater from University of Hyderabad. Is some mistake is there? Her publications and presentations focus on the question of identity in popular performance arts. Sarmila's forthcoming book is Cultural Politics of Odia Jatra, Structure and Representation. Expanding from her previous research, she is currently engaged in exploring the socio-cultural history of popular Bengali Jatra and its predominant influences on Jatras of other Eastern Indian regions. At Indian Institute of Advanced Studies, Simla, she's a fellow. Living in Northeast India, her new research interests are on gender, sanitation, and history of Tripura tribes on the border of Bangladesh. Sharmila is working on a project which traces the history of Jatra theater right back to the 2nd century BC, and then the several stages of it. Professor Ranjape has also explained that the inflictions took place during the colonial period, and it's shipped from theater, premium theater to film to celluloid, many other things. And now its latest use as a political theater in Assam, in Odisha, and Bengal, and also in Bangladesh. These are the various domains of her research which she is working upon. And because this audio is a lot of, video is a lot of problem, I don't want to speak much on it. I hand over the floor to Dr. Sarmila Chatterjee.
Thank you so much, Professor Purohit, and thank you so much, Professor Pranjape, the director of IIS. I was not expecting, sir, to introduce my work, and I'm really glad for that. And good afternoon to all my colleagues here present today. And before I start my presentation, I really want to say that how much I'm missing Professor Bijay Ramaswamy today. I was really inspired by her topic, though I really could not talk much, but we just shared one book all the time, that Another Harmony, and I hope she is in harmony wherever she is. And I'm really going to miss her, and I was expecting her in this presentation today. And with this, let me start my presentation. And I have noticed that many have used this forum to express their gratitude, but I will do personally when I meet and I think the time is right. So I will not take much time right now. And today is my final presentation, and I have decided to prepare myself in writing this time. During the discussion round, few photographs and videos, if time will be permitted, that will be presented. So as you've also heard by now that I have written on Odia Jatra, Odisha's popular traveling theater. This work, the work on Odia Jatra, took me about 10 years and never quite let me go, as it happens so often in academia. During the 6 years I spent in Tripura in the Department of Sociology, I had no time for anything, but was again after Jatra beginning some interviews and little archival research. This extended into the other northeastern regions I managed to visit during these years. Professor Pranjabe was very right. My topic is very vast. It's all because why I'm going to tell you that why one has to do this extension of the whole content of this project. So how much ever one would do the research, one would do on these scarcely documented regions, the case would always be remitted to the grandfather of Jatra, that is the Bengali Jatra, that I had circumnavigated for many years. So in my earlier proposal for the IIS, I had intended a comparative study of regional Jatras in Odisha, in Bengal, in Tripura, and also Assam. However, it was probably the time constraint that I had to focus only on Bengali Jatra. And but through our conversation, it became soon clear that Bengali Jatra itself would make a substantial topic. Back then, I was not fully aware about the actual scale of such an undertaking. Despite the authority of Bengali Jatra, there is no monograph or other book that would fill the need of a scholar or layperson. There are too many forms jatras over too long a stretch of history. Every historical section I had to deal with had its own challenges, but I shall come to it in respective parts of my presentation. So let's start from beginning. What is jatra? The jatra that I and other scholars are talking about is a modern theater form that is thought or known to have its root in pre-modern times. The modern avatar remains the major focus of research given its scarcely documented past. Thinking of what it is today, the name or term jatra is rather indistinct, but it is indicative of its historic predecessor. The etymology of jatra or yatra in Sanskrit translates, among other things, as pilgrimage, journey, or procession. A yatra originally may have been such a procession as was customary with worshippers and devotees at the time of the regular festivals of their own god and cult. Some kind of musical performance and sympathetic dance must have performed a part of procession. As to modern day jatra, of far greater importance than the name are the tags, such as folk or popular, that come along the performance genre. In my title, jatra is given as popular folk traveling theater. Underlying to my research is the concept of continuity and change, wherein folk and popular pose as two open ends in the ongoing evolution of jatra. In my introductory chapter, I have discussed these two terms in more detail, but I have decided to leave this theoretical debate aside in this presentation. In writing, I endeavor to keep the discussion simple and elementary, but it fills many pages despite. Further condensing it for this presentation would make it vulnerable for misunderstanding and remain wanting or further explanation. For now, let's simply talk folk as a rural form of theater and popular as a modern mass media version. I would like to come to my first chapter rather and say a few words on how it came to existence and what it means to me and the scholars who read it. The chapter is titled Evolution of Jatra in Pre-Colonial Bengal, and I had always tried to give it a wide berth. The early evolution is not really an evolution of jatra since nothing solid on jatra is documented before the 19th century. All that can be learned is more general on performance culture from Sanskrit drama and some other sources that can help to fill in the picture to some extent. Why then deal with this? I was told to myself many times. But there is a very good book by Prabhu Charan Guha Thakurta from 1930 titled The Bengali Drama, Its Origin and Development, which has helped me a great deal initially. The first chapter leads the reader through a density of Indological writings that have a bit of a deterrent effect and often search for earliest proof of drama rather than jatra. A second publication that has been utterly important is the first publication dealing with jatra by Nishikant Chattopadhyay, published in 1882. This man from Bangladesh studied at the University of Zurich and is rather well acquainted with the Indological writings of his time. I had a long been compelled to take certain things for fact until finally I had decided to review all these sources and get clarity once and for all. In this painful way, I was able to reconstruct the academic history of jatra research and thus provide the reader with a chronological apparatus and a certain assurance that it might not be necessary to return to those publications. One of the driving forces behind this, what I termed the Vaishnava origin of drama theory, my first subheading under this chapter. When reading on Bengali Jatra, one would repeatedly come across the assumption that theatre emerged from a Vaishnava background, an argument that has been so often repeated that it turned into a fact. In my chapter, I was able to show how argument travelled from Indologist Christian Larsen, 1852, Silva Levi, 1890, Albrecht Weber, 1873, then Chattopadhyay, 1882, Leopold von Schreuder, 1887, Honest Philip Harvey's 1912, etc., etc. The argument for the Vaishnava origin was, however, not based on much, and everything is related to drama in general, which most authors uncritical extend to Jatra. For one thing, Jayadeva's Gita Govinda reappeared in every publication, quoted as an example of early dramatic poetry, indicative of what performance might have been, though not necessarily dependent on the Sanskrit language. A second argument stems mostly from Weber in 1873 and pertains to Patanjali's Mahabhasya. Therein, it is the mentioning of Krishna and Kansa in connection with the performance and actor that prompts Weber. And from there on, all authors to reinforce Lassen's 1852 earliest Vaishnava theory of origin. Now, this is just to convey in lesser detail how things work. The whole theory has been emphasized by Nishikant Chattopadhyay, who had a certain bias for the Vaishnava theory and seemed to have had a considerable influence in this spiral. Chattopadhyay, in line with those Indologists mentioned, but adds a more contemporary chapter to the narrative by centering his narrative around one Kamal Goswami from Dhaka region, who has authored three Vaishnava Jatras in 1860 and 1871. The final impression that is left with most of the readers is that somehow Jatra is Vaishnava origin, even though the whole theory is based on the assumption and deduction from the present state of affairs. Another branch of early history is connected to the Chaitanya movement that I have dedicated another sub-chapter attempting a critical analysis of the actual facts. This involves through browsing or reading of a couple of thousand pages of Chaitanya biographies. Originally composed in Sanskrit and early Bengali, which I have not yet set out for. I had long since relied on vague quasi-quotations without proper reference, claiming how Chaitanya and his followers had been involved in some kind of Jatra performances. Carol Faber, 1978, writes a dissertation in the University of Columbia Chaitanya and his followers would frequently go on pilgrimage to important places of Krishna worship, but since they could not be constantly traveling, on return to Chaitanya home, that is Navadip, they began reenacting or rather dancing and singing the journey or Krishna episodes with costumes and makeup. This based on three Chaitanya's biographies or hagiographies, the Chaitanya Bhagavata by Vrindavan Das, the Chaitanya Mangal by Lochan Das, and the Chaitanya Charita Amritam by Krishna Das Kabiraj. This is what has commonly become to be interpreted as Jatra performances. It is clear that the movement championed Vaishnavism, but especially a cult around Krishna and Radha. The songs and poems composed these days had a huge impact on Bengali culture, seeping into folk art and remaining a cultural asset even decades later for Muslim converts. The general belief got established more from a general that the Jatra had its origin somehow along the Chaitanya movement. I'm still on my way to deepen my understanding on Bengali literature, but it is always has to be kept in mind that stories and epics has had long since been circulated through oral traditions and various professions of storytellers. So in that way, it is not proof too much in performance culture if, for an example, the oldest Bengali adaptation of Ramayana is from about 15th century by Kritibas Ojha. So against this Vaishnava dominance in the academic debate, there is a comparatively less emphasized line of argument from Shaiva text and in mythology. Chattopadhyay, the first to write on Jatra, profoundly mentioned it in a fleeting only, but von Schroeder had given it a good paragraph a couple of years later. Thereafter, only Guha Thakurta picked up that line of argument. It was argued that a major part of dramatic Sanskrit literature was dedicated to Shiva, for example. However, that matter, it seems to have been generally found, even though never really surveyed, that Vaishnava material has more story to offer for dramatic narration, which after all might hold true for the mainstream literature at least. I'm planning on a deeper study in order to get an overview of the balance between Shaiva and Vaishnava stories episodes. After all, Rama's inclusion into the Vaishnava pantheon and the avatar system has expanded the rapporteur considerably. The Bhagavata Purana, as well as sections from Harivansha, have contributed to the immense popularity of Krishna. So outside the mainstream literature, and especially Bengal is known for that, one would find complex narratives around Shiva as well. The Gon, for example, even though this does not directly refer to the region, have an adventurous narrative of Shambhu Sheikh, which could be an example of local narrative that can feed into Jatra. The folk deities from all together little neglected but an often mentioned aspect of early Jatra material. Manasa, for example, is frequently mentioned, and the snake goddess has indeed gained wider popularity in Bengal and even fought itself up into the literature. Chandi and Durga, or other forms of Shakti from another vital part of Bengal, Bengali culture, but have some reason been kept behind the Vaishnava or Krishna Jatra theory. For folk, various authors speaks local cult that might not have been the material of local Jatra performances. For professional troops, however, the Ramayana, the Devi Mahatmya, or Manasa, as well as might have had more broad familiarity to cover wider areas, if ever such early troops existed. But there's no such evidences or writings. But for Patuas and other storytellers, this is assumed. So I have applied my own thoughts on the matter and might as well one of them put out for discussion here. Dusan Vital, 1976, writes that perhaps the most conspicuous feature of Bengali literature is the almost complete lack of any secular writing before the 18th century, the only exception being a few works by Muslim Bengali poets. It has been stated many times that the bulk of pre-modern Bengali literature, both epic and lyric, is not religious in contents, but also sectarian nature. However, secular religious frame in order to be acceptable in literature. But any secular story or episode had to be given were expressed in these works. Vaishnava poets, for example, do not sing of love of a mother and for her child, but of Yashoda for the infant Krishna. They do not glorify the love of a man for a woman and vice versa, but of Lord Krishna and for his beloved Radha. So my readings of Bhagavata Purana sections from Harivansa and the Gita Govinda have reconfirmed my impression that Krishna story material has ample material to fascinate the audience. Sociology has, at least in the first 30 years, abandoned the glorified picture of an all-pious society when it comes to dealing with religion. So at core dominates human nature in all its complexity, and there are three elements of the Krishna narrative that responded to that. One, an element of sexuality, which I would especially emphasize, an element of violence in the guise of heroism, of course, an element of heartwarming beauty related to the early childhood of Krishna. So with these three ingredients, a play is bound to be successful. So this is what the background of history of origin in the pre-modern, the medieval time, if one would understand from the Indological writings. And this continuity of Krishna Jatras or the Krishna Leelas or the Chaitanya Leelas, to make it very clear. So episodes like Kaliyadaman is known as Kaliyadaman Jatra. They were not called as Jatra, but they were Krishna Jatra, but they were episode-wise called. So Kaliyadamana Jatra was for a long time was a very popular Chaitanya's musical performance. So the researchers over the name Jatra appropriate has been a major focus. So therefore, Bengali literary theater historians have attempted to translate the biographies of Chaitanya where evidence is of his performances. So now coming back to Jatra after Chaitanya and during Mughal period. So during Mughal period, I mean, there are again not much evidences of whether Jatra was, Krishna Jatra was continuing or not. But there are, one would see, find references from Bankim Chandra's in Banga Darshan in 1872 and references in Asiatic Society in 1816, where examples of Sishuram Adhikari of Keduli village, a reviver of Jatra from the Rajendra Lal Mitra's account, and Adhikaris and Kaliyadaman Jatra was continuing to be there by Sridham and Subal Adhikaris. And Krishna Jatra, Asiatic Society refers in 1816 that Krishna Jatra and dancing of boys in response to these adhikaris introduced new style, and from Krishna Jatras to the new style or the non-Krishna's stories were introduced, like Nara Damanti Jatra. But there is not much more accounts after Chaitanya Tiladhikaris. And this followed the Shokher Jatra, the immature Jatras, in the 18th century, reduced favor due to the introduction of Baiji's song with soothing tabla sounds and toppa songs were the regions of disfavors of Krishna Jatras by the Babus. Old Vaishnava lyrics were replaced by this toppa or light music. This is probably where the immature Jatras have come. So I think I don't have to get into this much because we don't have much time. And now I'm coming to the most important time, that is colonial time, where today Jatra has a complete connection. One would see there are connections and there are disconnections. That is what the pre-Chaitanya, pre-colonial times. And what happened to the colonial time and how it has been continuing? The form is dying and reviving, and it is still continuing. And in colonial time, one would see evidences in writings. So what happened to the folk artist in the colonial time in a newly generated elite and educated mass? Sumanta Banerjee outlines that the 19th century literary sphere in Bengal witnessed a period of struggle between the popular indigenous inheritance in poetry and the formulation of new modern poetry after English poetic conventions. Then also struggle between classical and folk languages. Then Navu, urban and mixed languages, colonial and native languages played an instrumental role in many negotiations between modernity and nation in the early 19th century Bengal. So within the impact of colonial modernity and rise of nationalist movement, parallel developments in the 19th century in this kind of performing arts were, number one, the revival of popular medieval Bengali literature, particularly the Bidya Sundar play written by Bharat Chandra. Quickly to tell you the story, which later became a very, very popular Jatra. Again, like Kaliyadaman Jatra, it was called Vidyasundar Jatra. And the story is a romantic poem of medieval Bangla literature based on the love between Vidya and Sundar. The work drew heavily on Chaura Pav Chashika by the Sanskrit poet Vilahana, a work composed in the 11th century. So the poet, the story, the beautiful and accomplished prince Sundar obtained a boon to marry the beautiful and scholarly princess Vidya. Sundar then reaches the kingdom of Vidya along with a parrot given to him by the goddess Kalika. He pleases the princess and with love letters and paintings sent through a flower girl of the palace, and they fall in love. Sundar then enters into the bedroom of Vidya through a tunnel and has sexual intercourses with her. But when Vidya becomes pregnant, her father becomes furious. The angry king then sentences Sundar to death by impaling. Sundar, however, saves his life and her life by pleasing the goddess and marries Vidya. So the adaptation of this play, one of the first secular plays, Jatra, is a turning point in the history of Jatra. The style of performance also got imbibed with a new kind of acting and singing style introduced by Gopal Ude. For instance, Khemta dance and a new way of verbal appellations. Khemta dance is connected with the Nachnis in Bengal. So there are many dialogues how things got changed, but I'm not getting into this whole changes. And the second change, what we see in colonial time, the establishment of European theatre and the emergence of Bengali drama from classical Sanskrit plays on European model. And this was the time of emergence of theatrical Jatra. So emergence of private theatre, public theatre, also emerged for democratization of Bengali theater and production of a hybrid theater as produced very importantly Girish Chandra Ghosh. And he wrote extensively on new hybrid aesthetics in Bengali. This all very in detail I had presented in my last annual presentation, so I'm not really getting into the detail, but the cultural hybridity, it is very important to come to the post-independence time, that this experiment with cultural hybridity, both Jatra and theatre, he was, Girish Chandra Ghosh was a believer of representing his art to both the marginalized lower class of British Calcutta, as well as combining his Occidental orientation to theatre and its collaborator Babus. The Jatra artists remain as the nucleus of Bagh Bazar Amateur Company, but not active in Jatra productions. So there are a lot of criticism to that that Girish Chandra Ghosh had to. And the third development happened to Jatra, the Swadeshi Jatra, which was emerged as a tool for anti-partition agitation, boycott movement, and national consciousness. I'll just pick up one very popular Jatra by Mukunda Das. Swadeshi Jatra was Matri Puja, which really drew attention of British officials, because and this led to the Dramatic Performance Act, and where Jatra was already also, some Jatras were banned. And so Jatra was taken as a tool for this kind of Swadeshi or nationalistic Jatras stories. So the Matri Puja is a play is about Bhagavati, who assumed the form of Kali and Chandika and remains the mother of all. So it is the India, it is the Bharat Mata, which has been projected through these religious figures here. To free the Devalok from the oppression of the Asuras, Bhagavati assumed the form of a slayer and protector. In the Pala, Durgasur referred to the sannyasis who fought for the freedom of from Britishers, and then, but here, the freedom of the Lakshmi, Angaraj, or Mother Goddess. And they sing, just one line I would quote, Moribo, moribo, tobo, dibona, dibona, janani, janma, bhumi. We will die, yet we will not surrender our motherland. So the structure of the form and content in 19th century to early century has also changed, the whole form, and also, of course, the content. So what are the changes that one would see from the 19th to 20th century? Very quickly, number one, the lyrical more, it is very lyrical. It was still very lyrical in 19th and 20th century, poetic with the jury system, which had not less than 60 songs in one play, and the original structure marked by the concert, a concert which is a prologue, you know, whole musical orchestra would sing, and then the jury, which is a singing of chorus, and the comic relief provided by the clown are still characteristics of contemporary Jatra, but these are the features that one would see immersed in the 19th to 20th century. So using a folk instrument having loud chords like dhal, khol, kartal, and many types of drums, kansi and mandira cymbals during the 18th, and later tanpura were the most popular instruments, and by the end of 19th century a host of Western instruments like tabla, harmonium and clarinet had found their way into Jatra orchestra. However, since Jatra is in a very, very flexile nature, so Jatra Walas in early 20th century have infused more dramatic element than its lyrical tendencies. And the themes evolve from mythological to historical and political narratives. Introduction of blank verses were also there. Apart from this comic and melodramatic strain, Jatra has always a well-connected plot or plots. And then the duration of Jatras, which was very important, one would see a change, and that has also a politics behind it. The long night performances in an open air thrills the audiences for a long, long time without any proper dramatic designs on the stage. Jatra plays last whole night from early evening and sometimes from midday till midnight, almost 12 hours. The green room is just behind the squared stage covered with a curtain. a wooden chair used as a king throne or any state official, religious dignitaries sit in is either a plain or covered with silk cloth, depends on the sponsor's investment. So that was the time the patronage was from the Jamindar, the landlords and the kings in Bengal. And the aesthetics followed by the courts of Sanskrit drama. This is where the borrowing from Sanskrit drama one can find, like which begins religious renderings to the stage. It divided, then started being divided into acts and scenes. And the beginning, it's a Prastavana, Bandana is offered, and Purbaranga is also followed by Sutradhar. These were all added to the Jatra in the 19th century. So, and introducing a very important character in almost all the plays called Vivek, the character of conscience Vivek in the play, which was introduced around 1920s. He usually dressed in long yellow robe and a turban, provided interlude between two acts, explaining the morals and the reasons for calamities and vicissitudes of the characters. Then there are changes in the dancing forms. What appeals to the audience of Jatra in its origin? Thakurtha Guha very, very clearly says that whatever the defect, I mean, that whether it is a dance, it's crude dance form or crude music, what is inherent in this artless performances of this nature may be simplicity with which they are presented excites the imagination of the audiences. They imagine themselves seeing or hearing things which is not being capable of being acted with such imperfect stage accessories. So this is, these are, and also very importantly, another feature which did not really change for long, that is the references of real women in action on the stage in 15th century with Chaitanya, but then there's no proper evidences or proof that women acted in Krishna Jatras. But then 19th century, early 20th century, mostly the young boys to act in the role of female characters. And what happened in Jatra in the post-independent period? So this was a critical time, particularly Jatra from 1950s to 1960s. And the continuity after each decline, it rose with new faces. And what happened? What is the reasons for this decline and again the rise? It was the commercialization. That's the period of commercialization. It is the growth of the Jatra industry in Kolkata. The emergence of professional Jatra parties in urban Bengal, those started from early 19th century. For instance, popular troops, as I mentioned, in the Adhikari parties in around 1820s. Then one would see the other professional party of Gopal Ure in 1835, Nutter Company in 1889. And by the 1920s, they were poorer. There are companies or the groups, professional, but more mobile version of the professional troops in Kolkata were operating. And by the mid-20th century, saw a tremendous growth of professional Jatra parties sprawling in famous Jatra Para on the Chitpur Road. It is obvious with the construction of the city, the spaces are also divided as per the economic or occupational category. Therefore, all Jatra parties opened their box-like small offices. I've visited several times, along with rehearsal halls in the 1970s. Now I'm just going to talk about the development of Jatra from 50s to until late 80s, and what happened within this period of time, the growth of professional Jatras, and all Jatra parties by 70s, as Carol Favers locates, Jatra Para is the locus of Jatra business, deals with Artha, the political economy and money, and it does so profitably, a way of ensuring a livelihood for about 1500 people, actors, singers, dancers, musicians, composers, writers, directors, technicians, managers, brokers, costume centers and sale people, publishers, printer, bus owners, servants of the artist, and the owners, adhikaris as called, of Jatra parties, all earn a major part of their living from their association with the professional jatra. Printing companies known as libraries on Jatrapala publish Jatrapalas as well as religious texts. The business of production of meaning, through these cultural performances. That is what Carol Faber quotes. It is a world of ledgers, payrolls, logistics, rentals, fees, advertising, income, disbursements, performance strategies, contracts, and the like, any other Bengali private-owned businesses. So the management of Jatra Party expresses concern over the expenditures and profits. Once you are there in the Jatrapara, or if you visit any of this company office, you would immediately get to know that what do they talk and expenditure, profits, where the party is going to be contracted. And while the actors, technicians, dancers, musicians, middle management and the support staff express concern over their salary, wages, this is what it's a, it is the whole scene that one would see in Jatraparas, in the company offices. By the mid-1980s, there were as many 150 professional troops in Calcutta alone. Sudeshna Roy, in a long article, she is in Telegraph, in 1989, she compares the unparalleled popularity of Jatra in rural Bengal with Bombay talkies only. There's no other competitor by then. So the biggest money spinner today in the world of Bengali showbiz is not the Bengali film or the theater, but Jatra in compared to the 60s and 70s, when it was a small time entertainment for confined to mainly villages. And this Jatra season, they have a season when this beginning of Durga Puja and last till the next monsoon. This has been changed now in the 21st century, the timing, the season now. The itinerant Jatra companies could reach places where TV, cinema, theatres or even cities' legitimate theatre did not have their access. The professional actors, and even they also do maintain branch offices at places like Asansol, Siliguri and Darjeeling in Bengal. The preferred destinations of these mobile theater companies were coal mine areas of West Bengal and Eastern Bihar, the tea garden areas of North Bengal, and the railway establishment in Lower Assam are the areas with the maximum profit potential for the Jatra troops. Changing as much as between, they do charge from rupees 15,000 to rupees 40,000 for one performance. This is the statistics of 70s. And they rush to next destination by modern transport, no more bullock cart. And but occasionally, due to unseasonal weather, political trouble in the countryside, wars or anti Bengali feelings in Assam, Odisha, Bihar, the contract negotiated cannot be fulfilled and they face financial constraints. So around the Bengali New Year's Day, contract for leading artists are signed. The larger the sum of money offered, the bigger the star bagged. Heroines are at times hidden away to keep them safe from the temptations offered by rival groups. Each group has its own, you know, the whole group of staff. And the salary, main actors had changed from rupees 50 in the late 19th century to rupees 75. That's what I have tried to document. The rupees 75 in the early 20th century and rupees 10,000 by 1970s. So the average show, also the crowd, which is also important statistic, the average show draws a crowd of at least 10,000 to 15,000, the average. And in case of big company like Nutter Company, which is 137-year-old company, the crowd can swell to 40,000 to 50,000. Of course, there are problems when there are performances with 40 to 50,000 audiences around. And the changes, what happened in the features of the post-independent time Jatra. The jury system and Vivek character already were dropped by 1960s. The last female impersonators lost their status because the real women already were there. The cabaret girls came to dominate. So on the one hand, as Samik Bandyopadhyay writes, that there was a decline of the old style On the other hand, the inevitable commercialization retained its quality through great actors and their old acting style. So there is a continuity and also change one would see, you know, at each period. So by 1960s, stereotype of jatras one would see, despite, you know, modernization, like being those of elder king, the prince, the younger prince, the singer Vivek, and the Vidushak, they are also existing simultaneously. And the duration of performance, as we saw, the duration of performance, which was there the whole night or more than 12 hours, it got reduced to 3 to 4 hours from 6 to 7 or 12 hours in earlier times. And introduction of microphones, taped sound effects and slideshows were very important, because if you are addressing a audience, which is a 10,000 audiences, the last audience to hear them, so only, you know, the bare voice from the stage will definitely, you know, it has to be high-pitched voice. That is where somebody, you know, I've just quoted Sudarshana Roy again, that while saying even tender things to their loved ones, they have to shout, they have to scream. So, and that is where the microphone has simplified actor's job. And their dialogues, unlike the in Westerwelle, they have to, they don't have to shout, you know, as the last row of the 10,000 has to hear them. And then again, lights were introduced. The Hazak, the Hazak light, they used to call the Petromax lights, replaced by flood lights and spot and mirror lights. And the all side open stage is now blocked off at one side with the screen at the back. Also, another important development happened, the Jatra movement in metropolis, in Delhi. In 1960s to 1980s, during Durga Puja and Kali Puja, where opera parties, they are called also opera parties, were also formed by the Delhi Bengalis. And sometimes troops also come to perform. But the only difference that one would see, jatras in Delhi, in metropolis, the modern jatras, whether in Bengal or Delhi, are breaking away from the traditional norms of jatra in style. Its style, its script, its presentation, its acting, they were highly theatricalized. So this is the break. Yeah. Am I very fast or is it okay? Professor Purohit, or I can go more faster. Okay. Jatra movement. Okay. Jatra became a. May I request to this new Professor Purohit? Yeah. Yeah. So, 1970s, it became a very viable mode of urban entertainment. And when they first advertised themselves in the Delhi newspaper, they were not advertising themselves in the newspaper, but the major reason is because it is largely for the rural Bengal and they did not have access to newspaper and the Mofussil rural audiences. They just, you know, they simply went to the nearest show wherever it was getting performed. So it was not necessary, but the change occurred because for the Calcutta audience that they started to perform. And only in around 1970s, when competition increased and the first superstars of Jatra, like Shanti Gopal Pal, who was known for his character, Hitler, came in. And in 1977...
Sorry, please bring Sarmila, bring her into the frame.
Am I not in the frame? Am I visible?
You are visible and audible.
Okay. Well, Ashwini has gone out. Yeah. So can I continue? Yeah. No, there was a problem of visibility, whether I'm in the frame, but Professor Raju said it's all right.
Visible.
Okay. So, one would see these posters behind me, the contemporary jatra. Maybe I'll come later. So So in 1977, radio programs to advertise Jatras for the first time. For instance, on a Sunday afternoon, the popular one-meter quiz contest used to be followed a little later by a 15-minute capsule on the famous Natta Company production, Natti Binodini. The capsule consisted of excerpts from the highest points of the play, interspersed with terse announcements of self-laudatory statements. And then the first of the Jatra reviews appeared in the art section of Anand Bazar Patrika. It just flooded after mid-1970s. Because whenever there was a space from the theater groups, then that space was taken by Jatra. And sometimes this single established groups, very, very known groups, they provide up to rupees 15 lakh, by the way, for the art revenue. So between 1980 and 1990, for around 20,000 people with about 300 opera companies, it spells employment, and for many Bengali newspaper, it means for their survival, dependent as they are on 3 crore in annual advertisements from a 50 crore industry that has now become, that is in 80s and 90s, the 50 crore industry. Mohan Chatterjee, an actor and proprietor of Mohan Opera, feels that it is taking the place of Bengali cinema, which has been unable to provide action, speed or entertainment to audiences who are craving for it. So Theatre in the City is still experimenting with Brecht, Shakespeare and Kurosawa, and it is too high flown for the common people to understand. So people require entertainment, not intellectual stimulation, an audience said. So for them, it is very, very easy to change, you know, the current public mood. And that is why probably, you know, themes like Phulan Devi's rise to fame. And then there are a lot of, you know, themes like President, Prime Minister, tussle is now being depicted in a classical theme in the 70s and 80s, where the Lord Shiva represent the president and the B.T. Narayan, the prime minister. And then tensions in the mother-son relationship after the daughter-in-law comes on the scene. So the theme about a lot of, you know, dozen of plays that one would find. So what happened? The Jatra does provide escapist formulas for tension-ridden middle and lower middle class Bengalis who love this Jatra. If form and content are the indispensable requirement for continuity of tradition, then Jatra has been a theatre of magic. Theatre of magic, said Utpal Dutt in his book 2009. So Dutt summarizes, Utpal Dutt, that the survival of Jatra is due to its distinctive feature. Number one, its mimetic elements. Number two, its robust and unashamed use of every emotion, every passion. And third, it seeks to dominate audiences' mind by sheer violence and brazen dramatics. And the Jatra players respect the taste and judgment of those rough and exhausted men, particularly the coal miners and tree garden workers. So the critical of these features, the post-independent Jatra tradition, people like Utpal Dutt, and there are a few more, they criticized and they used Jatra form for their political purpose. And they used it for more progressive purpose. So what happened? The spirit of communism was being in Jatra, both in political and non-political Jatra. I will be referring here or focusing Utpal Dutt's Jatra largely. So what happened? These, these actors or the directors or the dramatists who are educated in America or in Europe and then well exposed to this theater forms started experimenting with the existing or dying traditional performing arts. And it is just not in Bengal, it happened all over India, largely also Maharashtra, Bombay, then, Maharashtra, Bengal, and then it went to Kerala and Karnataka and other, wherever this experimental theatres started by the progressive dramatist. So the political with Marxist orientation and the non-political, especially the Shakespeare, did pose a spirit of communism from late 1960s till mid-1980s. So director like Utpal Dutt, Shambhu Bagh, Shourindra Mohan Chattopadhyay emerged as a new generation of artists, not only fraternity, but also for Indian theatre. And the leftists not only created a new genre of revolutionary Jatra Palas, but also inspired the next generation of Jatra actors, playwright, directors such as Shanti Gopal Pal, Brajendra De, Fanni Bhushan Vidyavinod, and Bhairav Gangopadhyay. They brought social criticism, but then they are different from Utpal Dutt's revolutionary type of Jatras. I have no time to discuss more that. Just now focusing on experimental Jatras, of Utpal Dutt. But before that, a focus is need on a significant event in 1971. I think all the theater scholars here, they know that 1971, a roundtable conference on modern relevance of traditional theater, which was conducted by Sangeet Natak Academy, where Suresh Avasthi was the secretary, and whole idea was to create a theater of roots. And that is where a paper which is presented by Utpal Dutt, the Yatra and its relevance, who emphasized the commercialization of Jatra and emergence of business tycoons are destroying the Jatra form. Interestingly, the whole discussion, it is a very important paper for us, that whole discussion of this theater, the dramatist present there in the conference. Okay. Huh. So this was the strongly committed communist ideology he started. So Dutt, you know, Utpal Dutt, who was a very, was a comrade in communist movement of Bengal, started all kinds of street theater, and also one of the founder members of IPTA. So who joined professional Jatra in year 1968, where he started the first play he wrote called Rifle. And he has probably directed 30 Jatras, and there are a lot of a discussion can be done that how did he get into, and then, but I'm just coming back to his two major success, the non-political, the Shakespearean Jatra, for the first time and only Shakespeare Jatra that was produced by Utpal Dutt is Bhuli Nahi Priya, the adaptation of Romeo and Juliet. I think I have no time to discuss this, how this whole, you know, post-colonial context, how it has been localized and, you know, translocalized. And it was very, very interesting to you know, see that how Shakespeare has been used in Bengal. And then then one more important political Jatra that one can also discuss, the Sanyasi Tarabar, which was, he thinks, Utpal Dutt thinks, in a very important play for him, which brought him to the limelight, and he the patriotism, the untethered potential of patriotism and violent armed rebellion, as well as self-sacrifice in the figure of Kripananda Bhavani Pathak, because he brought in all leaders, whether it is Devi Chaudhrani's and Bhavani Pathak and Ramanandagiri in one play. So that such a thing. Yeah. I think I'm not going in detail of this play of Sanyasi Torabari or The Crossed in 1972. So the whole message of armed revolt against imperialism through this Jatra Pala, the saga of Sanyas revolt, a part of India's history of anti-imperialist struggle, was being dramatized in this play. So and Dutt believed that this play wouldn't have had the same effect if it had been staged in a proscenium stage, and largely, you know, the whole, and he called for the whole revolution in the stage, and then criticized the commercial Jatras. So now coming to the contemporary Jatra, and that is probably in a continuously changing global world. And I have focused the contemporary Bengali Jatra in the 21st century. So, very sharing my observation.
Take care of the time also. Huh?
Can I take 5 minutes more? So the lot of features maybe we can discuss later. So what is happening right now with contemporary Jatra? Entry of Bollywood cinema and Bengali theater actors and television actors into it. And then the changes in the scripts and the whole commerce part also. And probably, you know, and the new kind of plays like London bombings, 9/11 issues, the imprisoned hero Saddam have been now current trends of some Jatra parties. And then I have observed few Jatras during my field work. I'm not getting into, this is the play. I've written the story and the narrative in a very, very short way. So what is it? It's a play. I observed in the Jatra festival, Hishab Kosha Bhalo Basai. I like to calculate. So very quickly, set in Kolkata and a village nearby, the play is about a young village girl, Titash, and her revenge against a corrupt politician, Felu Banerjee, in Kolkata. Two families are the center of the play. Titash is the sister of a Gandhian journalist, Nabarun. In his absence, Felu's brother-in-law, Tuhin, a pervert, he rapes Titash and kills Nabarun's father, and then takes the opportunity to send Nabarun to jail as he wanted him to write in favor of his coming election of the Felu Chatterjee, who is a corrupt politician. Then Titash comes back. She loses her voice, but then rescued by another protagonist called Sagar, and then who is disguised in a CBI officer, and they become modern business lady, and she acted as that she is from Dubai, and then they took the revenge against this whole corrupt politician family. And then finally the police comes and arrest everyone, and both the brother and sisters meet, and everything goes fine. So this kind of Jatras are in currently it is there. So and then problems, you know, there are a lot of problems. Largely criticisms that the Jatra has been losing its originality or Molikata. And then there was a whole photo exhibitions of the struggle of the leading actors, that they have steady decline of the number of people who like to watch Jatra. There is a decline in giving enough opportunity after the retirement. There are a lot of, you know, and profit generation is a major problem now. Then they become some Jatra plays become then greedy proprietor as they're hiring the Bollywood actors, loss of rapport with the audiences. And then that is where the state comes to rescue the fate of Jatra. So they have Paschim Bengal Jatra Academy, which was a part of the, you know, which was established in March 2005 under Information and Cultural Affairs Department, Government of West Bengal. And it organizes Jatra Festival for 32 long days in Kolkata. And then they go to their rural villages to perform. And it has a lot of activities they do, like they do this, conduct this festival. They organize workshop for young aspirants for Jatra, young aspirants or Jatra artists. They confer awards. They give grant in aid. They are now started paying pension to the old and the retired Jatra artists. And they are into publication of Paschim Bengal Jatra Academy journals. And they take care of their smooth mobility around the Bengal of these Jatra troops. So the lot of benefits have been given now. But then whole idea, the emergence of this state patronage, when the whole decline of Jamindari's system and, you know, kingship, etc. So what is it that the state patronage was there? What is a political strategy which is expanding? And so this is not a state, it is not only used, I think it's a Jatra which has been now used as a state propaganda which I have, and this coming to this, that why it has been a state propaganda, when I documented the speech given by Mamata Banerjee in last 7 years during the inaugural ceremony of this festival. So I had this excerpts of speech where she's been now focusing that from 2013 to 2020, that she has been saying that how Jatra is important, it is our culture, it is our heritage, but then she's been also focusing on her developmental skills, her successful projects like Kanyashri or where, and she's been saying that if Jatras can be produced on her schemes. And currently, the 2020 January speech, she says that I appeal to all of you to create a mass movement against NRC and CAA. Jatra upholds society and it reflects rural Bengal's ground reality, socio-economic resource and plight of the common people. If the issues like CAA, NRC and NPR are highlighted by folk theatre, it will have a direct and deep impact, said a senior Trinamool leader. So there are already lot of Jatras on Mamata Banerjee as a successful leader who patronizes Jatra industry. There are a lot of plays, and also Jatra directors see that Rabindra Sangeet should be there because it's a fetish of the chief minister, and it is the symbolic growth. So Jatra means journey and Mamata's journey, which reviving the Sikh Jatra industry. So and she is overthrown the 34 old Marxist regime in Bengal. So there are a lot of plays like Ma, Mati Manush, Mamta Re Dake Dilli Chalo. This was just recent where the Mamata Banerjee had, the direct reference to the Congress chief battle cry to defeat the BJP in Delhi and carve out a space for herself and like-minded parties. And then it continues. It is taking a cue from Bengal's chief ministers. A clarion call January 19, 2019, with a Jatra has been already produced. And the director says our Jatra ends with Didi's speech at the January 19 rally. And Jatra portrays the character of four Trinamool leaders. And it also portrays some BJP leader, but not Narendra Modi or Amit Shah. So nor is there Abhishek Banerjee. Which is the intra-party feuds that's been depicted. So that is it, and this followed epilogue where I'm planning to do, it's not because I'm still writing, a critical discussion on Bengali Jatra in this last five centuries, and then a comparison Odia Jatra will be also there. And this is what the popular culture and the changing social structure one sees, that it is evolved from within the framework of continuity and change, and the both orthogenetic evolution and the heterogenic encounters that one see, that the religious movement, the Bhakti movement, the political invasions, cultural assimilation of language, literature, nationalism, rise of communism, colonial modernity as directly influenced by the European theater in the late 18th century, then Bengali theater, cinema, and popular literature. So that is where Jatra has been, Bengali Jatra, like Odia Jatra also. It has been so resilient culture. Yeah, I'm stopping here. Professor Purohit, if you.
Have you done it? Have you done well? Now, she has so extensively and comprehensively spoken on the history and experiments of the theater, including this one, which provokes the theory of use it in NRC and CAA. Vanity of her research. Now, audience is free to ask. Remember, I may not be able to connect every time, So in case my connection fails, you can ask direct question, Sharmila ji.
Oh, it has to be muted.
I am a little bit confused. There are a couple of statements that you've made. Are you able to hear me?
Yes. Yeah.
So one of the statements was that the yatra was I have an important call. Can I postpone my question? Can somebody else go ahead?
Professor Balram Shukla is visible on the relationship.
I'm sorry. Okay, so what I was saying was I was confused by the two statements that you made. One, you said that it is revolutionary. And second, you said that, you know, it is not that hi-fi, brushed and so on and so forth, but it is something which appeals to the emotion, like Bollywood. And that it has incorporated elements of Bollywood now. So I am a bit confused. How do you have both? Because whatever my experience has been with street theater, it's very limited, maybe 2-3 years or something like that. The audience reaction can be very puzzling. It all depends on, I mean, whether you are able to establish a link, and it can depend upon. Whether it is the middle class or whether you are in a slum or whatever, and the reactions can be very different. So I don't understand how all this stuff is covered under one umbrella.
Very interesting. That is where probably I mentioned that, you know, there are experiments with Jatra. That is where Utpal Dutt came with that, you know, Jatra should be revolutionary because we need change in the society, not entertainment only. So, and his experiments, when he started with Macbeth, which was performed for 98 times, and then this Romeo and Juliet, Bulinai Priye, he has been written on in all his accounts that they were extremely successful in rural Bengal. And that is where he used this form for his revolutionary jatras. And then it was accepted. It was accepted. And simultaneously, the commercial jatra companies, there are also middle jatra dramatist playwright who were writing also the, you know, sort of sympathetic towards this whole communist ideas or revolutionary or change or criticism, the social criticism, as well as entertainment. Yeah. So people, it is very interesting in Bengal context, particularly that, you know, the political chachas are equally popular like the entertainment. I think this is a debate which we all do with popular culture. Whether there should be, you know, deep commercial cinematic themes or narratives, or there should be progressive ones. And what people actually like to see. Producers say people like to see some cheap, vulgar, or, you know, family oriented jatras. There are experimental, like Utpal Dutt or Shambhu Babu would say, or even Ganguly, which is extremely popular in Bengal. Let's say, no, these progressive themes are also equally accepted by them. So this is a contradiction that one would see in every form of, you know, tradition that we have, whether it is cinema, theatre, it is folk theatre. This contradiction between this, you know, progressive and entertainment or non-progressive is image. That I think we will discuss. It's a long discussion, and it is always very confusing and contradictory to each other. Thank you, Professor Raju.
Please come forward.
Yeah. Can I ask? Yes. Can I ask a question?
Please go ahead.
Okay.
Your mic is on.
My mic is on. Sharmila, since I have worked on Colonial Proscenium Theatre, I have a question. How did this Jatra survive the onslaught of the Proscenium Theatre? Because though Proscenium Theatre was mainly an urban affair, I have read in the biographies and autobiographies of the contemporary period written during the 1920s and 30s that gradually, even during the festival times or the Jatra seasons, quote unquote, that you use, that many of the zamindars or the local zamindars or the landlords would invite the theater parties from Kolkata to perform at their estates instead of the Jatra, instead of the traditional Jatra.
Just a moment. Balramji, your mic is on. The video is off, your mic is on. It is creating a lot of disturbance.
Just repeat the question.
But it is because this is interesting, because contemporary sources reveal that Jatras had a tough time competing with the theatres from Kolkata, because Proscenium Theatre mainly developed in Kolkata and functioned in Kolkata, and the expenses that were carried out in conducting these shows were quite huge. And the Jatras during, I am talking about the early 20th century till independence, till 47. I am not taking it to a later period. How do you explain that? How could the Jatras survive this competition, if we can say?
This is also a very important question, because can you just mute your mic?
Yes, of course.
So this is important once again, because there is a whole emergence of theatrical Jatra, or what they call Jatra theatrical, exactly in that period of time when Girish Ghosh, or Jatra, has been criticized for its form and not to the intellectual level. So, and then Girish Ghosh brought this hybrid Jatra into proscenium, and then probably that is where Jatra probably got its elevation, once again taking from proscenium. And that is the period, that is the late 19th century, and then Swadeshi Jatra certainly came, and other troops, they were only operated in the village level. They're all, they left Kolkata. I mean, the urban was not attractive to them anymore. So that is where probably, not much writings except, the Sushil Day or Dinesh Das, they would... They have mentioned that, there are poorer groups operated in rural Bengal, but not because legitimate theatre, or what you say, the proscenium theatre, had completely dominated in the urban stage and did not let these, and particularly the criticism, the continuous criticism in the newspaper and the journals were actually making them, to be, and the urban, I mean, the by then, 1920s, there are already professional Jatras, as I said. They were poorer, but they were very, very mobile in the rural Bengal. So that was the problem period, but there was not much writing, and I could not make that what was the status, but this was there, like Panchu Sen, and already Funny Vision Bidyavana, they were more popular in the rural than, but theatre, proscenium theatre, the introduction of cyclorama, they're already there in there. And that is probably the popularity gained because of the newness, the theatricality in Jatras. Yeah. Maybe we can discuss more when I write down.
What about the nomenclature of the Jatras, of the contemporary Jatras? Because they give very interesting names to the Jatras, to the plays that are going to be performed. So have you looked at it?
शर्मिला मैम सुन रही हैं आप?
पूछिए सर।
Can I just complete this? No. May I just complete to this question? So the nomenclature, what you said, like that, for example, there was a two names called Jatra title, Pujarini Bodhu and Pukhure Bhasche Bodhur Lash. The Bodhu is a Pujarini, the name of a Jatra. Another Jatra name is the dead body of the Bahu is there on the pond. And you know which one was like more popular? The second one, not the Pujarini Bodhu. So the it is a very, very important to say that, you know, they grab the most bookings depends on the title. It's nothing to do with the text most of the time. And this is what very interesting to see. Yeah, Professor Hadda.
हाँ मैम, ये बताइए कि ये मूलतः लोकनाट्य था जात्रा, वर्तमान जो जात्रा का रूप है वो अपने लोकनाट्य से कितना दूर आ गया है, और क्या उस लोकनाट्य का, मूल लोकनाट्य का अभी जो जात्रा है उसमें कुछ बचा है या नहीं?
सर, ये जो सवाल आपने किया है ये शायद पूरा मेरे प्रोजेक्ट को क्लारिफाई करता है कि क्या चेंजेस हुआ है, कुछ मर गया है, कुछ चला गया है और कुछ बच गया है, लेकिन कुछ दूसरा रूप ले लिया है। ये लोकनाट्य से ये लोकप्रिय नाटक हुआ है, एंड देन ये है गणनाट्य और द मास थिएटर। ओके, व्हेन इट ये जब कमर्शियलाइज्ड हुआ और यू नो कमोडिफिकेशन हो गया कल्चर का, सबसे इंपॉर्टेंट है, दिस इज प्रोबेबली मैं अपना कंक्लूजन में लिखना चाहती हूँ, अभी क्या बच गया है, व्हाट इज रिमेनिंग इन द लोकनाट्य इन द कॉन्टेम्पोरी टाइम। आई मीन इट वॉज वेरी वेरी इम्प्रेसिव कि अभी भी जो इनका ओरिजिनल स्टाइल था, एक्टर्स खुद गा के और खुद गाते हैं, सिंग देमसेल्फ, आई एम सो सॉरी मेरा हिंदी अभी निकल रहा है।
अंग्रेजी में बोलिए, नो प्रॉब्लम,
मतलब बहुत बेकार सा हिंदी बोलती हूँ तो
हाँ। नहीं नहीं, आप अंग्रेजी में बोलिए अच्छा रहेगा।
हाँ, नहीं नहीं, मैं क्या बोल रही थी कि the originality, that singing, because it was started with a lyrical, it's a musical form, it was a musical form, then it became a theatrical, and today whatever you say cinematic, etc., etc., but the musical, the lyrical, where the singers themselves sing, is still remaining. This was amazing. I've seen in 2019, I've seen in 2020 videos, this is still there. The concert which was in late 19th century is still the same. Before the play start, it's just the same. And then, of course, the whole lot of other elements have come and gone, but the musicality still remains. That is the lokanatya ka abhi bhi, gananatya ho gaya hai, lekin ye originality abhi bhi isme hai. Bahut kuch hai, baat kar sakte hain sir baad mein.
Thank you.
थैंक यू शर्मिला फॉर गिविंग अस ए वेरी डिटेल्ड अकाउंट ऑफ द स्टोरी ऑफ जर्नी ऑफ यात्रा फ्रॉम मनसा टू ममता एंड दिस स्टोरी हैज मेनी डायमेंशंस एंड एज ए हिस्टोरियन लॉट ऑफ थिंग्स आर देयर व्हिच कैन बी ऑफ इंटरेस्ट ऑफ historians. Ritra has raised one pertinent question, and Professor Hara has also added one dimension to it. I think your project is very well conceived, but my first observation would be that it moves in many directions, and you have to think, you have to bring all these things together somehow. I mean, you are still working, so I can hope that you will be able to come out with very strong argument. So I hope that. For me, the most important question could be that this journey tells us that Jatra becomes a kind of territory which is open to various kinds of changes which can come from society. Okay, there was a time when one group was important. They could make use of it. And the USP of this medium was that it was an entry point to the rural audience. The people had some kind of a historical link with this kind of a form. And this continues. And that is the strength of your Jatra, because at one time various religious groups were there which actually made use of it in order to popularize their own whatever they wanted to. There was a time when nationalism came into the play, and this continuance of nationalism in this whole medium is something which is to be thought about, because you have referred to one Jatra of Utpal Datta, which comes in 60s or 70s. And so this continuation of nationalism and religious themes are two very important points which can be thought about. Why these themes remained important in this particular form. But what is most problematic in this kind of a reading is that you have to come up with an answer that whether Jatra is able to continue with its form, or it has completely transformed in such a way that anybody who has got the power of money or any other kind of power, they could come and use this medium for their own purposes. Because you have mentioned very clearly, if I'm following you correctly, that there was a time when progressive force, quote unquote, they used this medium for propaganda purposes. And the same thing is happening right now, where a particular party is making use of it in lieu of certain kind of concessions it is able to give to the performers, and thereby making use of this kind of platform for their own political purposes. This is not something which is unique to Bengal. This happens even in Maharashtra, and it can happen anywhere. But my submission to you would be to look for the continuity points, how they struggled, how they adjusted with social realities. You have to spend money, you have to run the show, and so you will have to compromise. But still, there are performers, there are people associated with Jatra who have been trying to keep it Jatra and not anything else. So that is very significant, because Jatra is not street theater. Jatra is something different. Jatra is not a street theater. Jatra is not something like any other form. Jatra has its own sanctity. And I remember one of the NSD person telling me that in fact Jatra is a purer form of theater. And he was referring to certain kind of uniqueness which is associated with Jatra form. So all these things come into the play. When you are making a kind of historical, making a historical narrative of it, and you are bringing pre-colonial period, and even within colonial period, various kinds of changes, you will have to bring up one important argument from the people who still believe in Jatra as a form. Otherwise, it happens that, moneyed people, powerful people are coming and making use of it, sort of kind of thing, which does not actually give us anything really substantial from this great story of Jatra. This is what I wanted to submit before you.
Professor Patel,
Mila, may I also intervene? Professor Patel's question is very pertinent. There are two things in a theater form. One is the style, and another is the theme. So his question is it being overwhelmed by the contemporary presses of themes or contemporary questions of politics, or does it still retain the same theatrical form? By theatrical form, I mean the language, the music, the dance, the structure, because there are many folk theater forms in this country. For example, the Tamasha, for example, Bidishya, for example, Nautanki, for example, Budeva, or for example, this Kariala theater of Himachal Pradesh, which can very easily be converted into or very easily be used as a medium for political propaganda. Probably that is the question.
Thank you so much. I completely agree with Professor Hitendra Patel and Professor Purohit. This is what probably, you know, I also wanted to say. This project, which is very vast in nature, and this project came much later, when I joined this institute. And this project is incomplete at this moment. I'm not talking about the criticality of the whole narration that I gave about Jatra. And I really thank you, Professor Patel. This is what, at the moment, I'm going to do. And definitely once I, you know, start looking at critically that why the change and why this continuation of, you know, for example, this where they see till the revolutionary Jatras of Utpaldat, etc., and how this whole commercialization is also been there. So one really I have to look at it and develop my argument in this, my concluding chapter. So because of, you know, great constraint of time and I could not really, you know, develop this. So, yes, and the second thing is, you know, you also said that why, you know, it does it have a form or it is, you know, the change is the complete transformation. It is purer form. I don't, there are a lot of, you know, this is very relative debate. It is a purer form or not. That is why 1971 Roundtable Conference is very important to look at that. It is formless. All folk theatre form, where there is a call for, you know, change or use folk theatre, the indigenous form, in proscenium theatre or the proscenium theatre to be used by folk theatre form. So that is where the whole debate was coming that, you know, that can we really have a theatre of roots? Can we really have a, you know, theatre which can use this and can also be a different way? So this is, and that is the, that is where the Suresh Avasthi wrote a letter to Samik Bandyopadhyay saying that, you know, because of this formlessness, particularly Jatra, it is used for every purpose that we see. And then all the folk theatre, rest of the India, you know, being used for a different purpose, and proscenium theatre, particularly the urban theatre dramatists is using it for the urban audiences in a different. So one really has to do a very, very critical, you know, understanding of this formlessness or the purity or authenticity of the form or discussion.
May I come in for 30 seconds? 30 seconds only. I mean, just, I would like to add one point. Can you hear me? Last year, the person you have referred, what is the name you mentioned, right? I forget the name, but I heard it from him that what Jatra lost is the opportunity for actor to really act. This is the point which was raised by an important person. I'm forgetting his name right now. He said that in Jatra, there was a direct connection and the actor actually acts in Jatra in a much more direct manner. So for an actor, this kind of a medium gives more space for acting. And he was making a very important distinction between the earlier Jatra and the Jatras which came later on, or even a theater. And he was making a very subtle point that in earlier times, there was a direct connectivity between the great actors and the audience. Okay? But now the medium itself is changed in such a way that now medium is becoming very costly. There are people who are running it very differently. They are running it like a profession. So the form's purity is gone, form's scope for actor is gone, and a new kind of people are running this kind of theater. Now, if you bring in those stories, then this story of Jatra becomes a story of the society and societal changes also. And that is where your project becomes very important. And in that connection, this commercialization issue, you will find large number of people protesting against this kind of commercialization, even in those days. And so your space gets divided. One set of people trying to defend that art, its distinctness, its uniqueness. And on the other hand, there are people who are realistic people who want to do what people want. So this debate becomes very important in any form, you know, unless and until you bring in those kind of details and those kind of debates within that space, your story is not going to give us much more, because unless you bring in those the differences within that space. I'm not talking about this Jatra and society. I'm bringing the voices emanating from the space itself. That is where you have to be a little bit more, more concerned about the differences within that space.
I completely agree. I mean, I completely, being a you know, student of sociology or popular culture, I agree completely that, you know, it just not mirrors the society, but it is, you know, creating the voice of the social structure. That is very important, that how it is actually, you know, created, recreated in different changing or unchanging social structure. That is where probably my whole larger debate is confined, that the transformation, the changes because of the social forces, number one. On the other hand, how these social forces are being depicted or, you know, enacted in this performances are very important. So one should really do a critical, writing and putting everything together in my epilogue. I will definitely take your point in a very right spirit. Thank you so much, Professor Patel. There is a question I see here, Professor Purohit. I think you were able to also see from Professor Subramaniam. He's asking, my question is, what do you think about the whole politics and political business behind the Jatras? Are you there? Can you hear me, Professor Subramaniam? If you're there, I would like to, you know, talk to you later, because it's a very larger question, and I will like. Don't hear you, Professor Subramaniam.
My questions are different. Hello.
Do you hear me? Hello.
Yeah, I can hear you.
I think this whole question is about my project. I mean, it's a whole cultural politics one needs to understand, and the politics is everywhere the moment you take up any jatra. Whether it is, you know, colonial jatras or post-colonial jatra or post-independent jatra or the contemporary jatras. I think it is a very longer discussion, and I would like to do it with you personally. Yeah.
Sorry, my questions are different. My questions are very smaller and simpler. Just look at the ones above, 1, 2, 3. The three questions on the top, please. Look at this.
I don't see these questions here.
Scroll up, please. Scroll up.
Okay. Yeah, now I see questions. Sorry. So what kind of language was used, and how did it change over time? Was it closer to popular idiom or Vadraluk language? This is a very important question. Actually, the language originally, you know, as we discussed, is Krishna Jatras or the mythological ones. Definitely, it was the Bengali, which was very the Bengali language, which was vernacular in its own way, not too Sanskritized. That is why probably the whole criticism was emanating later on about the cheap language or the vernacular language, which was not Sanskritized, yeah, and closer to popular idiom, yes, not closer to Bhadraluk language, because you know when you have Shiva and Parvati coming to the earth, yeah, and talking like the ordinary people, yeah, that is where probably it always appeals to the rural. Not the Bhadraluk in urban Bengal. Yeah. And the second question, you mentioned that the jatras were popular, particularly in coal mines in these days. Did the development especially put it addressing the issues of? I do not have exactly any play which were like performances largely in the 70s and 80s, and it's still going on. Definitely there, but I don't have any jatra as such, if I know, which are addressing, you know, directly the issues of miners or garden workers. Yes, and the jatra script printed in Chitpur Road in South Bengal, which were called the libraries, and still I saw only one shop, you know, a jatra books, which is still there. The old jatras, and then also in College Street you have a few more shops which or the printing press which are still largely printing the old jatras, and because the contemporary jatras all are now getting recorded, the video recorders, and all available in from cassettes now to the cheap CDs are available. And Kiran, which is the first one who started the video shooting, it is he has been putting it in the YouTube. So the script, the which were printed in the colonial time, what Sudhita Chatterjee was saying, in the market of Bartalas, you know, the Bartala dramas, the chap books. It is largely in that Bartala areas of North Bengal. Yeah. can't hear you. Please unmute the mic.
Yes, आवाज आ रही है? आवाज आ रही है?
आ रही है.
यात्रा में हुए परिवर्तनों को, रूपांतरणों को सकारात्मक अर्थ में भी लिया जाना चाहिए. उसका कारण ये है कि जो भारत के जो लोक नाट्य रूप समय के अनुसार नहीं बदले, वो धीरे धीरे समाप्त हो रहे हैं. राजस्थान के दो लोक नाट्य रूपों को मैं जानता हूँ, जैसे ख्याल और नौटंकी, अब वो लगभग खत्म हो रहे हैं. यात्रा में जो परिवर्तन हुए हैं, यात्रा का जो रूपांतरण हुआ है, उसका जो व्यवसायीकरण हुआ है, उसके कारण कम से कम वो जीवित तो है. तो मुझे लगता है कि समय के अनुसार ही परिवर्तन तो मुझे लगता है जरूरी है, वो होंगे भी. सही
है, लेकिन अभी अभी का जो माहौल है कोलकाता में प्रोफेशनल यात्रा कंपनीज का, बहुत अच्छा नहीं है स्टोरी उनका. वो भी बोल रहे हैं कि यात्रा धीरे धीरे उनका बिजनेस, पर्टिकुलरली उनका प्रॉफिट, उनका बिजनेस कम हो रहा है. और अगर बच्चे का भी यात्रा एमेच्योर ग्रुप्स में, और नहीं तो कुछ अलग रूपांतरण जरूर होगा इसका. सो अभी का जो माहौल है अभी भी उनका, लेकिन कॉन्ट्रास्ट टू दिस, ओडिशा में यात्रा इससे डबल कमर्शियलाइज हो रहा है और बहुत बहुत तेजी से बढ़ रहा है. लाइक एक एक यात्रा पार्टीज का तीन तीन ग्रुप्स होते हैं, पांच पांच ग्रुप्स होते हैं. सो बढ़ रहा है क्योंकि बदलाव है, एंड इट इज नेसेसरी, इट इज वेरी नेसेसरी. ओके, या सो लास्ट 5 minutes वी हैव एनी फर्दर क्वेश्चन. प्रोफेसर चहल, क्वेश्चन आई वुड लव टू गिव, बट देन वी विल डू दिस. इट्स अ वेरी वेरी कॉम्प्लेक्स एंड लॉन्ग क्वेश्चन टू बी आंसर्ड राइट नाउ, बिकॉज अश्विनी इज गिविंग मी ओनली 5 minutes टू आंसर.
What is the question? At least we want to hear what is the question of Professor Chahal.
What do you think about the whole politics and political business behind the yatras? It is very much there. What you said from Manasa to Mamata, the Mamata Banerjee. Now what Amit Shah has also said, come to the center and take up the business, take up the position. And it is going on. The whole theater politics is always on in Jatra. That is the most interesting part of Jatra. Balram ji, kuch bolenge?
Nahi, samay kam hai.
Ek choti si cheez bolni thi. Aapko ek to badhaiyan deni thi. Bahut acha presentation aur bahut achi tarah se aapke prashno ke uttar mein vishay aur bhi spasht hua. Shuruaat mein aapne kaha ki yatra shabd jo hai, wo uske artha aapne bataye Sanskrit se lekar ke. To ek to ट्रेवल और एक एक आपने प्रोसेशन कहा था उसमें समारोह. तो संस्कृत में इस अर्थ में ये शब्द है क्या यात्रा का? बस ये जानकारी हमें चाहिए थी, क्योंकि हमने कभी इसको यात्रा को समारोह के अर्थ में प्रयुक्त नहीं देखा, प्रोसेशन के अर्थ में प्रयुक्त नहीं देखा.
बहुत बहुत इसका उदाहरण है, जैसे रथ यात्रा पूरी का और स्नान यात्रा, एनीथिंग रिलेटेड टू जगन्नाथ का यात्रा इज ऑल प्रोसेशन. और सभी हरिवंश में बहुत ही इसका उल्लेख किया गया है यात्रा,
मतलब एक ऐसा समारोह जिसमें डिस्प्लेसमेंट भी वो हो, इंक्लूडेड हो. ऐसा समारोह, ऐसा प्रोसेशन जिसमें एक जगह से दूसरी जगह जाना एक तरह का डिस्प्लेसमेंट अवश्य हो, उस वो समारोह, वो यात्रा, वो डिस्प्लेसमेंट या वो ट्रैवलिंग. सामान्य रूप से जो ट्रैवलिंग है वो ये एक तरह से धार्मिक यात्रा हो गई ना, ये केवल. तो यात्रा विशेष अर्थ में जो यात्रा में यात्रा है, या बंगाली यात्रा में यात्रा है, वो विशेष अर्थ में प्रयुक्त है.
मतलब ये बहुत बहुत इंटरेस्टिंगली डिस्कशन हुआ है ठाकुरता गुहा, पर्टिकुलरली चैतन्य मंगल, कि यात्रा ये जो थिएटर फॉर्म है और यात्रा जो पिलग्रिमेज है, मतलब एक जगह से दूसरा जगह, और रिलीजियस पिलग्रिमेजेस और प्रोसेशन जो मैं बोली कि शाही यात्रा, रथ यात्रा, स्नान यात्रा एक्सेट्रा, जो उसमें वो प्रोसेशन जो चलता है एक जगह से दूसरे जगह चलने में, तो लेकिन ये थिएटर फॉर्म का नाम यात्रा क्यों हो गया?
जी
ये दोनों तरफ से मिले जी, हम इसके बारे में बात करेंगे बलराम जी।
हाँ बिल्कुल,
हम पड़ोसी
मैं हम चर्चा कर लेंगे बाद में। ठीक है
प्रोफेसर शुक्ला, ये प्रोफेशनल थिएटर जो शब्द आया है ये मध्ययुगीन यूरोप से आया है, जहाँ पे मिरेकल एंड मोरालिटी प्लेस चलते चलते रथों में लाद करके दिखाए जाते थे। एक रथ जिसमें सृष्टि की उत्पत्ति है वो आके एक जगह पे रुकता था, पूरा दिखाता था कि हाउ दस In 7 days, I created the earth and the sky and everything. And the seventh day became the Sabbath day. ये processional theatre के forms बहुत ऐसे रहे हैं, लेकिन हमारे हिंदुस्तान में यात्रा शब्द शायद इसलिए आया है कि वो रंगमंच जो जगह जगह यात्रा करके परफॉर्म किया जाता है। तो मैं आपको एक नारद की यात्रा का अपना हिमालय का उदाहरण देता हूँ कि 6 महीने तक यक्ष की यात्रा होती है और हर दिन किसी गांव में रुकती है शाम को, और गांव में रुक करके फिर देवताओं का शयन करा के फिर दैवी और मानवीय नाटकों का मंचन किया जाता है। उसको भी एक जनरल थिएटर में एक जनरल टर्म इस्तेमाल किया जाता है, प्रोसेशनल थिएटर। तो प्रोसेशन कभी कभी वो ये प्रोसेशन जो है अपने आप में एक पूरे मिथक का अभिनय ही है। जैसे नंदा देवी की 22 दिन की यात्रा होती है, तो मिथक में जहां जहां वो रुकी थी, जहां जहां लोगों से उसने जो इंटरैक्ट किया था, वो यात्रा निकलती है लाखों में, और जहां जहां रुकती है वो अभिनय वहां पे होता है। उसको कहते हैं रिचुअल रीइनैक्टमेंट। वो पूरी यात्रा नंदा देवी के मायके से ससुराल जाने का ही रीइनैक्टमेंट है, और बीच बीच में कुछ घटनाएं जो विशेष हुई होंगी मिथक में उनको भी रीइनेक्ट किया जाता था। तो ये इसलिए एक एक जनरल टर्म है प्रोसेशनल थिएटर यात्रा के लिए। पिलग्रिमेज भी है, पिलग्रिमेज तो है ही, जर्नी भी है, लेकिन प्रोसेशनल पूरा प्रोसेशन पूरा का पूरा जुलूस चल रहा है, इसलिए उसको प्रोसेशनल थिएटर। प्रोसेशनल मीन्स टू मूव फ्रॉम वन डायरेक्शन टू अनदर डायरेक्शन।
थैंक यू सो मच फॉर द आंसर। Yeah, so we have to conclude. Professor Purohit, if you want to conclude the session.
ये बहुत अच्छी शर्ती और बहुत विस्तार से हमें ज्यादा थिएटर का, क्योंकि ज्यादातर चैतन्य महाप्रभु से थोड़ा उन्होंने कैसे यात्रा शुरू की थी वो जानते हैं, और उत्पल दत्त ने कैसे फ्रीडम मूवमेंट में इसका प्रयोग किया था, ये बहुत थोड़ी बहुत जानकारी हम लोगों को होती हैं। लेकिन आपने पूरे विस्तार से इसका इतिहास बताया, इसके प्रयोग बताए। लेकिन एक चीज जो प्रोफेसर हितेंद्र पटेल ने पूछी, क्योंकि इसकी जो रसानुभूति है दो तरह की है, एक तो शांत रस वाली धार्मिक वाली रसानुभूति है, और अब प्रोफेसर बलराम शुक्ला बता सकते हैं ये नए किस्म की रसानुभूति, ये 10वां या 11वां रस, क्या राजनीति का रस भी शामिल हो सकता है नहीं हो सकता है, जो इसमें शामिल हो रहा है, इसका जो इस ईडियम का प्रयोग हो रहा है। कुल मिला के बहुत अच्छी प्रस्तुति रही, आपको भी धन्यवाद, वेब उस वेब से जुड़े हुए सभी श्रोताओं का भी धन्यवाद। थैंक यू। चाय की व्यवस्था नहीं हो सकती आज है?
जल्दी होगा सर, इसका एक बार कोरोना खत्म हो जाए।